This is a tire. It's the only part of your car that's actually touching the ground. And if your tires don't have grip, you're not going anywhere. At least, not in the direction you want. But if you're looking to go as fast as possible, it's not as simple as just getting the most expensive rubber you can afford. Do you want maximum grip or a whole lot of slip? Well, it's both, actually. The secret is there's a sweet spot, a moment where the tires are both gripping and slipping in a combo to give you the fastest lap times. So, we got pro driver Nick out here to show us how to find it.
That's right. I'm gonna take this FRS out on the track and show you a little bit about slip angle, just as soon as we get that wheel back on the car.
What? Oh, God, yeah.
You've probably heard the saying that slow is smooth and smooth is fast. And somewhere along the line, a lot of people confused smooth with not sliding at all no matter what. While it's true that drifting around every single corner isn't the fastest way down a mountain, despite what Initial D may have taught you, you actually do want your tires to slide a little bit. Understanding and controlling your tires at this critical crossover point makes such a difference as a driver. It's so important to lap time that I literally called my car control clinic Fast Sideways. So, what is slip angle? Well, it's just a measurement of the difference between the direction your tires are pointing and the direction you're actually going. Simple enough. If that angle is 0 degrees, you're driving normally. If that angle is 40 degrees, you're drifting. But somewhere in the middle is a sweet spot where your tires can actually generate more grip. You know what? Let me just show you. As the tire goes around the corner, the rear tires look almost as if they're sliding laterally. But there's no tire smoke, and the tire isn't losing traction. It's deforming. Since the tire itself is flexible, it deforms when you apply a force. In this case, that force is lateral load. Now, the tire is only touching two things, your wheel and the ground. So as you apply a lateral load, the tire is deforming between those two points. At the contact patch, the tire is actually flat to the ground. Not only that, the tread block is slightly rotated, creating that slip angle. Now, to show you exactly what's going on, we would need a plexiglass racetrack, which we don't have.
So I've come down to Porsche Santa Clarita, where they've got the next best thing. I'm standing in the Wonderground, a semi-secret museum they've built out below the dealership to showcase some truly special Porsches. Do yourself a favor and check it out sometime. It beats the hell out of my basement. Anyway, before we get too distracted by all these cars, let me direct your attention to the reason we're here, these massive glass panes in the ceiling. From above, they're like a teaser letting you peer down into the museum from the showroom, but from below, they're one of the few places you can park a car and actually see what's going on where the rubber meets the road. Not gonna lie, did not expect them to say yes when we asked about filming this here, nor did I expect them to provide this beautiful Spider RS for the demonstration. But the folks at Galpin Motors and Porsche Santa Clarita are good people who like doing cool shit. Anyway, here we go. If you look at the tire, you can see the contact patch clearly. The tire is round everywhere else, but flat where it meets the road. It's also kind of a triangular shape because of the wheel's camber, but that would square out in a turn under load. Since we're looking at the front tires though, we can give the steering a little turn and you can see that even though the direction the tire is pointing has changed, the contact patch hasn't turned as much. And the difference between the direction the tire is pointing and the direction of the tread in the contact patch is your slip angle.
Man, that's so cool. I wonder how much weight that holds.
So really there's kind of two different types of slip angle. The first is a tire deformation, and that's happening all the time. Anytime that you're cornering, that tire is deforming, and the difference between where it's pointed and where it's going, that's your slip angle. And the second type is the tire actually sliding or scrubbing across the surface of the track. And when you are driving at speed, you're probably getting a blend of the two. When you start to get really experienced at feeling and utilizing slip angle, A, you can get more out of the tires and just corner at a higher speed. And B, you can use that slip angle to your advantage. By changing the difference in slip front to rear, you can help to rotate the car through a turn. And this is something that's used all the time, especially in low speed turns, to get the car pointed so that you can get on the throttle sooner and get a nice fast exit.
As the tire rolls, the car is also rotating. The contact patch can't do both at once while maintaining grip, so it sort of stays in place. When that patch of rubber leaves the ground, it conforms back to what the rest of the tire is doing. If you start to carry more speed and create more slip angle, the elasticity of the tire begins to hit its limit. But the tire doesn't just snap back all at once. As the edges of the contact patch start to slide, the center will still have that ideal slip angle and therefore still have grip. Yeah, you might be able to hear the tire squealing, but even at this point, you're still not losing grip. You're on the absolute limit of the lateral load the tires can take. You can see this represented in a slip angle curve. This shows the amount of grip a tire has at a given angle and a specific lateral force. As you add more angle, the lateral force the tire can handle eventually plateaus. But it's a soft roll-off, so you've got a little bit of leeway to find the sweet spot, which, for some tires, is wider than others.
The more comfortable you are with manipulating the slip of the car and the slip of the tires, the faster you can go through those turns without fear of losing control of the car. And you may notice that if you are in the middle of a turn with slip, like that, your hands are really active. You never get a chance to just hold one steering angle. Now the car's still staying on a consistent radius while that's happening. So why are my hands all over the place like that? It looks sloppy. But what's actually going on there is the slip angle of the tires, all four tires, is constantly changing. And if I don't move my hands to match the actual trajectory of the tires, the car's gonna go somewhere other than where I want it to. Best case scenario, I end up just a little bit offline. Worst case scenario, I end up off track in a wall facing the wrong direction, upside down and on fire.
Now, slip angle is most visible in the rear tires because I've got control over the angle of the fronts and that's constantly changing. But a well-balanced car can achieve slip angle with all four tires. Optimum slip angle is a moving target. It's determined by how much the tire can deform before it fully lets go and you begin to slide. That amount of deformation can be affected by tire temperature, air pressure, and of course, tire compound. In the world of motorsport, some slick tires can handle incredible slip angle, often 7 or 8 degrees. Old bias ply tires can be as high as 20 degrees, and dirt racing tires like for rally or circle track achieve optimum grip at 30 degrees or more. When it comes to 200 treadwear tires, like the ones you might have on a sports car of your own, you'll find that some can give you more slip angle than others. For example, the Toyo R1Rs have been shown to be a little less grippy than the average 200 treadwear tire. At certain tracks, they could be a second or two slower than their new Proxxis Sport R. But you can get a higher slip angle out of them, which means that they are great communicative tires to learn on. Every tire has a known slip angle curve. Well, I say known, but it's probably more accurate to say consistent, because tire manufacturers really don't like giving out information this specific. There are plenty of independent testers and people dedicating the time to deciphering what these tires can do. But I think the best way to get to grips is to go out and feel it for yourself.
Pretend I'm an idiot. Actually, you don't need to pretend. Because tires are made of flexible rubber, there's a little bit of leeway between the point where the tires start to slide and are actually sliding, right?
Basically, yeah. And as long as you're within that happy window, you're gonna be at peak cornering speed for those tires.
This was not on the video, but when we took a lunch break while filming this, I took my Hyundai Ioniq 5 out here on the track just for funsies. Those tires were absolutely screaming. And they are low rolling resistance Kumho tires, not the same as what you've got on here. But what I was experiencing hearing that, was that the maximum slip angle?
Yeah, or it could be higher than the maximum desirable slip angle. The tires will start to make noise, sort of at the front side of that bell curve when the slip angle starts to come into play. And then the sound will get louder and louder as you get closer to the top of that bell curve and the maximum amount of slip angle that they like. Then if you keep going harder and harder and asking more from the tires, the slip angle will increase, but you're not getting any more grip out of it.
Gotcha. So speaking of different tires though, how do things like sidewall or tread depth affect the way the slip angle is coming through?
Yeah, there's a ton of factors in the tire that's going to affect how much slip angle it wants. More and deeper tread blocks is going to create more tire slip. Fewer tread blocks, all the way down to a full slick, is going to create less tire slip. But it's not no tire slip. There's always some that's required for the tire to take you around a corner.
So this reminds me of that famous video from like a decade ago of that guy crashing his M4 leaving a meet, and he blamed uneven tire pressures on the rear wheels. I think it was like 1.5 PSI. That obviously that was the cause. Like, no way, right? Like that, the difference in the characteristics and how those tires would grip or slip does not vary with 1.5 PSI.
Yeah, absolutely not. I mean, Is there technically a difference with 1.5 PSI? Sure. Is that what that guy experienced? No. He just had used his big dumb right foot and spun up the rear tires, and that was that. And it should be said that this really is a racetrack technique. You shouldn't be trying to use the slip angle of the tires while you're on the street, lest you end up like our buddy in the M4 and his 1.5 PSI discrepancy.
And I guess if you do end up getting pulled over for squealing your tires, you can try telling the cop, "That's just slip angle, buddy. See how far it gets you." I don't know. That's on you. Thanks for watching.